Okay, so this is the question that is given to you, and you have to prove it that this is regular or not. Okay, so again, I have told you various methods to verify that a particular language is regular or not. So you can again do that again. But if you want something substantial, like if I asked you that prove that this is not a regular language or prove that this is a regular language, only then this pumping lemma will be employed. Okay, so if I just want a mathematical proof that something like this a raised to power n and b raised to power n is where n is greater than equal to 0 is not a regular language, I need a proof of that. Okay, so if you want to prove it, so for that proofing you need a pumping lemma. Okay, so the pumping lemma is just a mathematical procedure to prove that a particular language is not regular. Okay, keep that thing in mind, that pumping lemma is a pumping lemma is only there to prove it that a particular language is not regular. It will not prove that a particular language is regular. Okay, it will only prove that a particular language is not regular. So there is a difference between that. So this is a negativity test. Okay, so now the question that is given to in the previous class was a raised to power and b raised to power, I think m, yeah, and m is greater than equal to 0. So I know that you know about this, that this question, that exactly this language is a regular language, because we are able to draw the DFA for that. Okay, so I have told you like 4 or 5 methods to verify that a particular language is regular or not. So based on that, I can easily say that because I am able to draw a finite automata, as well as I am able to write a regular expression. So regular expression will be A star B star, okay, such that this star is not dependent upon this star. So I can easily able to write the regular expression also. So both of these methods, you can draw a DFA and you can write a regular expression. You can directly say that this is a regular language. But if I want to prove it by a pumping lemma, so can I prove this, that this language is regular or not by a pumping lemma? Just see this, follow the procedure. The procedure is very, very simple. Okay, so I'm just start with the same thing, that I just replace this n and m with p. Okay, so a raised to power p, b raised to power p. Okay, so now what I do is first of all, the length of this one should be greater than equal to p. So the length of this w string should be greater than or equal to. So it is saying that it should be at least p. Okay, so if you say depending upon the value of n, such that every string w in L of length at least p. Okay, so it should be at least p. So if you take a look at it, the length of a raised to power b, the length of a will be dependent upon the value of p here. So the length of b here will be dependent upon the value of p. So I can say that both of the length, if I calculate the length, it will be 2p, which will be greater than or equal to, which is at least p. So that condition is satisfied here. So I do not need to worry about that. The second part is just write the language for this p equal to 1 or p equal to 2. So you can apply p equal to 1. There is no doubt in that. And there is nothing wrong in that. So I prefer p equal to 2. Okay. So now what will happen in that the pumping string, now pumping length is equal to 2. So you can raise a raised to power 2 and b raised to power 2. Okay. So now if I just write like this, a and b. Okay. So I have to divide this w into x, y and z, such that y should be greater than or equal to 1. And the length of collective length of x and y should be less than equal to the pumping string. So what is exactly the pumping string here in this case is 2. Okay, so I just write it like this. So now choose it. This will be your x and this will be your y, and the remaining part will be your z. And now just take a look at this. The length of y is 1 here. So it is satisfying this condition. And the collective length of x and y is 2 here. So 2 is less than equal to 2. This is also correct. So both of the conditions are correct. Now go for the third condition. The third condition is x, y raised to power I, z. So I have to pump the strings here. Okay. So how? Now just replace the values here, x, y, and z. So the value of x is a, the value of y is again a raised to power I, and the value of z is bb. Okay. Okay. Now raise it to the power of 2. So I just raise it to the power of. raised to the power m, where okay. Okay. So the language in consideration was a raised to power n, b raised to power m, where n and m is greater than or equal to 1. So see, this string lies in that. So it can lie in that double a and double b can lie in that. There is no problem in that. So this strings lie in this language. Again, if you see the pump the string like I equal to 3 here. So a 1, 2, 3 bp. So 4b and 2b also belongs to the language in the same way. If you pump up any length, so only the length of the a will increase. Okay. So if I just do it 1, 2, 3, 4 a's and 2 b's, it also belongs to the language. So if I just say that's a equal to a star, so the length of this can be any number of times. So this star can be any number of times. So it will always lie in the language here. So it will not change that, because here if you write the regular expression of it, because this is again raised to the power of star. Okay. So everything will lie in the language. Still, again, I can say that this particular language, that is your a raised to power n and b raised to power n, I have given it to the pumping lemma theorem and it has passed the test. Okay, so the test is passed, but I still cannot say that this is a regular language or not a regular language. Okay, so keep that thing in mind. Okay, sorry for that. I think there is something wrong in the access point. Just let me see. Okay. Okay. So now I cannot correctly say that this particular language is regular. Okay. So I cannot prove by pumping lemma, I cannot prove that this particular language is regular here. Only I can prove that this particular language is not regular, but it is passing the pumping test. Again, that there is a question of whether this language is regular or not. So that is the sole reason I do not want you to only dependent upon the pumping lemma, because there can be some questions where you pass the test. If you pass the pumping test, then what? Okay, so then you are still stuck again that whether this language is regular or not. Okay, so it may so happen in this particular language. You can see that it is passing the test. It is very easy to say that yes, this is a regular language, because you also know about this. Okay, but there are some cases when some kind of other language which is exactly not a regular language is also passed by a pumping lemma. Okay, so that language is worst. So what I mean to say that sometimes what happens in this particular example, you have seen you already know that this is a regular language. Okay, so now it is passing. So you will be saying that why it is not regular, because it is passing the string. Okay, so I am because if you are looking at this particular example, in this particular example, you will be thinking that this is a regular language. So you are not wrong. But what happens in that if you take any other example, suppose a language that is not a regular language. Okay, so it can also happen that this not regular language also passes the pumping test. Okay, so that is why there is a safeguard here. If it passes the pumping test, I am again not sure that this language is a regular or not. So that is a little bit of a downside of pumping lemma, and that is why I do not prefer of using a pumping lemma, because it only ensures one part, that if your language is not regular, then only you can say that a particular language is not regular. But if it is passes the test, I cannot be again sure that if it is regular or not. Okay, so that is the sole reason I have given you some pointers to identify your regular language here. So I think you got the point here. If anybody has any doubt regarding till pumping lemma, if you don't understand anything, just shoot a text in the chat box. Okay, so just let me get the chat box. Okay, so I just want to again stress you one point here. That one point is, now you will be thinking that suppose there you are pumping the string like x raised to power y raised to power z. Okay, so when you do not need to check for all the strings. Okay, so you only if you are able to find at least one string that does not belongs to the language, you can directly say that this is not a regular language. Okay, so there is no need to check for multiple strings. Okay, so if you are able to find only one string also, if suppose in the starting one here, I'm not able to find that this belongs to language, this belongs to the language. So I am keep checking it. So by checking it, I got to know that because this is a A star, how many A's I will pump, it will always be in the language now. It will lie in the language here. But what happens is that when we are doing the, in the previous question also, you have seen I am pumping like two or three times. Okay, so I raised to power two or I raised to power three. So there is no need to pump for two or three times. If I raised to power two, suppose there is something like this x raised to power yyz. If this string does not belong to the language, so you can directly say that this fails the pumping lemma and the language is not regular. Okay, so it just for your own intuition, I have shown that you can pump the strings like this. But exactly, if you are able to find only one string also that does not belong to the language after pumping, you can directly say that that this is not a regular language. Okay, so keep that thing in mind. I just showed you that you understand that how I am pumping the string, but there is no compulsion that you should look for everything. Okay, it so may happen that sometimes when you pump the string, it can happen that x, y, y, z can belong to a language. Okay, so that is why if it is belonging to the language, just see for another pumping. So pump the strings more number of times so that you can get the pattern that why it is happening. Okay, so exactly what is the reason behind and what is the logic behind pumping lemma is it again based on the same thing that I have said the AP series is based on. Okay, so what exactly this arithmetic progression series is based on, I have on this only take care of the something called a common difference. Okay, so what happens in that common difference, it's if some successive terms have a same common difference, then mean I am able to employ a loop there. Okay, if there is applicability of loop here, so it means I can represent an infinite pattern into a finite pattern. Okay, so like your for loop, what exactly is your for loop? It is a way of representing an infinite pattern into a finite one. Okay, so now what happens in that, what is exactly a pumping lemma here? So what you study these conditions, if you clearly take a look at this condition ensures that you will always land this condition that you have. We are compelled to go by this condition. These are necessary condition. If these conditions are satisfied by the applications of this condition, I will always land on a part of the string that will be on a loop. Okay, so that is the logic behind it. So that is why if you pump it, then the same thing will also belong to the language. Okay, so that is also based on the something called a loop there. Okay, so if you are this condition make ensures this conditions of pumping lemma ensures that your y will always land on a loop here. Okay, so that is the logic behind pumping lemma. So now in your syllabus, after this chapter, after this pumping lemma, it is this is written that decision properties of regular languages. Okay, so there are some decision properties of regular languages, but exactly regular languages has two type of different properties. The first property is called your closure property and the second property is called your decision property. Okay, so the decision property will be more clearer to you when we study Turing machine. Okay, so don't worry about that. I will explain each and everything to you in the decision property. It is not very difficult. It is just a table to remember, but I will again tell you everything that is present inside the property. And but I also want to ensure this disclosure properties are also very, very important. So I will, what I will do, I with the decision property, with the decision property, I will also explain the closure property of regular languages. Okay, so it is written in the next module, but I think that it will make more sense if we studied disclosure and decision property together here. Okay, so decision property, if you remember, I have told you in some tutes, I have also given you the example. Why I'm saying that it will be more clearer to you when we done this Turing machine, because Turing machines introduces something called decidability and undecidability. Okay, so if you remember, I've said that if you call to a customer here, if you make a call here, then it is possible that customer care is saying that please wait, your call is very important to us and waits for like 20 minutes, we will get back to you. Okay, so you have waited for 20 minutes, after that your call is again not picked, and you again given a timer of 40 minutes, so please stay with us and we will again, our agents are busy in another call, so I will wait for 40 minutes, I will again get to your call. So after 40 minutes, you are again given another timer, like 50 minutes, 60 minutes, and then certainly you are given another timer for 70 minutes. So at that time, you are like I do not want to wait for so long. I just want to quit, and you just hang up the call. Okay. So it may so happen that the time suppose after that when the 70 minutes are over, you just become impatient and hang up the call. Okay, so it may so happen that after in the 71st minute your call will be picked up. Okay, so it can also happen, but you will never know that because you have hanged up the call. So again, there is no way to know that whether after 1 minute, suppose it can also happen that you have waited for another 10 minutes and your call is not picked up. So it is a very difficult question to answer that whether this can happen or not. So this is probably called, this is specifically called a halting problem. So when to stop. So this is a very, very, very good problem in the context of this decision property. So this exact problem is undecidable. So if you clearly see that I'm not able to decide that whether I will wait for 10 minutes or whether I just hang up the call. So that is why some properties of these languages are written like this, that they are decidable, and some properties are labeled like this, that they are not decidable. Okay, so it also covers your algorithm part, that I will tell you about it more when we discuss. So don't worry about it. Firstly, I will tell you about every decision property. So mainly main decision property I will tell you after reaching to the Turing machine. I will repeat that part. Okay, so don't worry about it if you do not understand it. I will repeat that part after we're done with the Turing machine, so don't worry about that. Okay, so I hope you understand it. This is not very difficult to understand. It is very, very easy. Just it will make more sense when we have studied Turing machine. Okay, don't worry about it. This is very simple. Okay, so now the closure property goes like this. So then what exactly is closure properties of our regular language? Okay, so just wait for a minute. Now I will again tell you that closure property and decision property for regular language, for context free language, for context sensitive language, and for recursive set or recursive numerical set exist. Okay, so there is a table for the closure property, and in that table it is written that yes or no. Yes means it is closed, no means it is not closed. In the table, again, for decidable property for every language has a particular decidable property, context sensitive as well as recursive and recursive enumerable. And it is also written like the table is drawn, there is also the property is given like this, and in front of it is just written like this, that is undecidable and this is decidable. Okay, so that is all. The table only contains one part of the closure property, yes or no, and the decision property only contains one part, that it is decidable and it is not decidable, undecidable or decidable. So okay, so now what exactly is a closure property. So I just give you a little bit of introduction to what is a closure property. Suppose this is a set here. So this set is consist of all the natural numbers. So natural number, this starts from 1 and up to infinity. So it is 0, it does not come in that natural number. So this is a universal set of a natural number. Now what I do, I take one natural number from this set and I take another natural number from this set and I apply a operator here. So some operator, it can be any operator. And carefully listen to the definition here. After applying the operator, if the resulting number is also natural, then I can say that OP is closed under natural number. So what exactly is the meaning of that? That if, suppose this is a natural number, I've taken the natural number 1, I've taken another natural number 5, and I applied the operation plus, okay? So now what happens at plus? Now it will become 6. Now 6 is also a natural number. Now I will say that plus is closed under natural number set, okay? So that is the basic meaning of closure property, okay? So now this is again another thing. I can say that this natural number is closed under plus, because if you try any other combination, any combination of natural number, you will always get a resulting number as a natural number. Okay, so if you apply and take any number from this set and apply a plus there, you will always get a natural number. So that is why I'm saying that this plus is closed under natural number. So if you are able to find at least one problem, if you are able to find that natural number 1 and apply any operator between these two natural number and the result is not natural number, then you have to say that this operator is not closed under natural number, not closed. Okay, so if you are able to find at least one instance that is not satisfying this property, you can directly say it. So it is again like pumping lemma. If you are able to find at least one instance where your resulting number is not natural, you can directly say this, that this operator is not closed under unnatural. Okay, so all the operators we have already seen. So again, I just show you the table also first. Just let me show you the table for the natural number also. Okay, so it will make more sense if you understand this. Okay, so this closure property table is also already uploaded in the LMS. Don't worry about that. So if you clearly see the general properties of this union, intersection, set difference, complementation, intersection with a regular language, concatenation, all of these general properties are written here. And if you see that regular set is always closed under these properties, it is already proven, so don't worry about it. Some properties I will prove it and some properties you can again see for yourself that this is already closed. Okay, so now this property table is already uploaded. So this is your different languages recursive set RE. I will tell you about it, don't worry about it. So you will be thinking that we have taken so much time in regular languages, how we will be able to cover CFL, CSL and recursive, and it will not take much time because you have understood a regular language. The underlying concept for every language is same, so don't worry about it. It will be very easy to do this. Okay, just let me get back. How do I get back? Okay. What happened here? Just let me see what happened there. Okay. So I think my desktop is different. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So now I think most of you will get that point, that if you are able to find at least one instance where your natural property, this operator is not closed, you can directly say that this is not closed. Okay, so the operator are very, very easy. You have already seen it. Your union operator, this union operator, it is also called your OR operator. It is also denoted by union, this one, or it is also denoted by plus. Okay, so you have seen this many number of times, this plus operator. Okay, so now it is already proven that this this plus is closed under under a regular language. Okay, so how can I say it? So just take one set like language one, and this language one, suppose this language one contains a raised to power n, b raised to power e raised to power n, and again the language two contains another thing that that contains b raised to power n. Okay, so now how can you combine these two? So just this language is absolutely regular, and this language is also absolutely regular. Okay, so just apply a concatenation between them, a raised to power n plus b raised to power n. Okay, so if you see, you are again able to draw NFA for it. So it is again the resulting language, and this is a resulting language. This thing is also a regular language. Okay, so because you are able to draw NFA, you can again say that this is also a regular language. So that is why I'm saying that take any, this is your regular set. This is your regular set. Take any language from this regular set. So it will be R1, and apply the concatenation operator between them. You will always get a language that is closed under that. You will always get the language that is regular. Okay, so I can say that this plus operator is closed under the regular set. Okay, the second one, again, you have seen this many number of times. That is your concatenation. So most of the operators we have already seen. I'm just discuss these operators in detail so that for CFL, CSL, and another language, I do not need to discuss for it that what exactly is the meaning of this. Okay, so now in the concatenation operator, if you see in the table, it is also it is closed under it. So just take two languages. Suppose another language, one language is raised to power n, another language is a raised to power b raised to power m. This is your L1 and this is your L2, and you take a concatenation, meanings you just take a raised to power n and dot is your concatenation, and take b raised to power m, and this will become a raised to power. Okay, so I think this language I am able to draw NFA, so this is also a regular language. So that on the basis of that I am saying that concatenation is closed under a dot here. So some of you might be thinking, I know that what you are thinking exactly. I think that some of you might be thinking that if a regular language L1 is this a raised to power n, where n is greater than 0, and another language b raised to power n, where n is greater than 0. Okay, so when I combine these two languages, so it will become L1 and L2. So it will become a raised to power n, b raised to power n, and this particular language is not regular. So how can I say that this concatenation operator is closed under concatenation? Okay, how can I say that this concatenation operator is closed under regular set? Okay, so there's the explanation for that. Now, why it is not regular? This is, again, if you remember the first cute I have told you, but this is the first language, e raised to power n, and n is greater than equal to 0. So what is the exact language set for this? The language set for this one is, because this is greater than 0, so it will be epsilon a and triple 4a. So you get the point here. In the same way, the language set 2 will be b raised to power n, and is greater than equal to 0. Okay, so the language L2 will be this one, epsilon b, then bb, and then bbb, and then bbb. You get the point here. Okay, so now when I take a concatenation of these two languages, L1 R concatenated with L2, if you remember in the first tutorial, I have also told you how to take a concatenation. Now concatenation is taken epsilon with epsilon, epsilon with the b, so it will be b, epsilon with bb, so it will be bb, epsilon with bbb, it will be bbb, and epsilon with the 4b's. Okay, so you get my point here. Now take the concatenation from this one. So it will be a, then ab, then ab, b, then abbb. You get my point here. Okay, in the same way, take this and aa epsilon aab, and A B B B. I think you get my point here. Okay, so if you clearly see the concatenation set is not a raised to power n, b raised to power n, where n is greater than or equal to 0, but the concatenation set is a raised to power n, b raised to power m, where n and m is greater than or equal to 0. Okay, so in this part only a same number of a's and same number of b's will come. So if you clearly see that here same number of a's and same number of b's, but the equal number of a's and equal number of b's is not in this one. Okay, so the concatenation operator works like this. Okay, so it have you have to take a concatenation of two languages, you have to do it like multiplication. So you have to take every language and concatenate or place it together with the other language. Okay, so it looks like a multiplication, but if you remember what exactly is a string concatenation, you just take one thing and take another thing, you just place it together. So I don't think you can call it multiplication, but it works like multiplication. If you are multiplying, you have to take one term and you have to take a concatenation with every other language. Okay, so that is the main difference between that. So again, if this question, that type of question is asked, exactly if you concatenate L1 with L2, so this will not be the answer. So this question is also asked in competitive exams. So what they do in the competitive exam, they just said that L1 is a raised to power n and L2 is b raised to power n. So we have taken the concatenation L1 and L2. So this cleverly said that we have taken the concatenation of L1 and L2. So all of you might be thinking that L1 and L2, now L1 and L2 is regular. So this is say that taking a concatenation of L1 with L2 is regular. So they have given this option. And then is it true or not? Okay, so this is true because the concatenation of regular L1 and L2 is regular. This is absolutely true. But most of you will get confused here, because if you concatenate it like this, a raised to power n, b raised to power n, all the students get confused here, because this is a classic example of not regular. Okay, so keep that thing in mind when you are concatenating. You just have to apply these things so nobody can confuse you. Okay, so that is the main difference between that. But there is something that is also an exception here. I will tell you about this one. This property is called infinite union. Okay, so this property is not it is a very interesting property, I will say, I must say, because what happens is that the regular language is not closed under infinite union. I will tell you about it, what is the meaning of it, don't worry about it. The regular language is not closed under infinite union. So this is an exception in case of a regular language here. So exactly why it is not closed. So what happens in that, suppose this is a language one, and the language one is a raised to power a b. Okay, I can write it like this. And another language is to this one, a2 b2. Another language is this one, A3, B3. Another language is this one, A4. I think you got my point here. And up to N, it will be AN and BN. Okay. So now if I just take a union of it, L1 union L2 union L3 union L4, it will become if L1 plus L2 plus L3 plus L4 plus LN. Now what exactly this will be, A1B1 plus A2B2 plus A3B3 plus A4B4. If you remember this part, if I want to write this language in a shorter way, I can write it like this, that this is exactly a raised to power n, b raised to power n, where n is greater than equal to. Okay, so why I am talking about infinite union, so the take a single language and union, because this is an infinite number. So this LN is an infinite number. So that is why I'm saying I am taking a language, I am just infinitely combining it and taking a union of it. This language, if you clearly look at this example, that if I just do this and take a plus 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 between that, it will become a raised to power N. and p raised to power n. So that is why this is a very good exception. And if you see in any book, this kind of a property is not mentioned, infinite union. Okay, so what happens, I think this is a question that is asked in, I think, ISRO or gate level question. What they do, they just given this thing that infinite union is closed under regular languages. So most of the students is thinking that because union is closed under this regular language, so they are also thinking that infinite union is also closed. Okay, but I just want to tell you that don't assume blindly. Just take a little bit of example. Like if you have taken this example, you will get that this is not closed under it. So only this is the exception, and that too is not given in any book. But this is this. Keep that thing in mind that infinite union is not closed under regular language. So that is the only property that is not closed here. So this is an exception. So this can become this a raised to power n and b raised to power n. Okay. So that is also very, very good question asked in a competitive exam. So that is why I want to tell you about this. Okay. I hope you get this one, that only this property is no, but all the properties are mostly yes here. Okay. So then another property that you have already seen, concatenation. After concatenation, there is a property called clean closure. Okay. So the clean closure property is, I think, L1 raised to power star. So suppose any language will not be dependent on the different star. Okay, sorry for that. Okay, so I just take any language that is regular. So I think AB is a regular language. So I just raise it to the power of star. So again, the resulting expression is again regular expression. You can again say that on the star here, it is also closed here. So under clean closure, so keep that in mind, the property name is clean closure. So under clean closure, it is also closed there. Okay. So now the fifth one is your complementation. If you remember the part where we have complemented. So what is exactly is the meaning of a complementation here? Okay, so if you remember in the first tut, I also told you about this, that that what happens if you want to take a complement of a NFA. So suppose this kind of scenario is given to you. So what happens to if this is your D1 and this is your D2, and D2 is a complement of D1. So what you do, you just take the states and with the final states. In D1 will be non-final in D2, and the non-final states in D1 will be final states. Okay, so if I just do this, that will be my complement. Okay, so if you remember this, I think this type of thing, I have explained the property of this in the first tut or second tut, I think. Okay, so now if you clearly seeing in what happens is that how are we taking a complement here? We are taking a complement of a automata of a DFA. By just changing the final and non-final state. It means if for a particular language, suppose this is a particular language, suppose AB. Now in the complement, you can draw a NFA of that. So that is also possible. Now to take a complement of NFA, you just have to do the same, that replace the non-final with final and final with non-final. So the resulting solution will also be a NFA, okay? So if you're thinking about it, if you take any language and first of all, we're talking about a regular language. So it is absolutely possible that if it is a regular language, then its NFA or DFA is possible here. Okay. So if I want to take the complement of this language that will L2, then I just take the NFA of that language and just apply the procedure of this one, that make final and non-final. And final as non-final and non-final as final. So you will again get a solution that contains a NFA. So it means our resulting thing is also a regular. So you can again say that under complementation, it is closed here. Okay, yes, it is closed. Okay, so I'm just explaining you the properties. Already the table is given, don't worry about it. So first of all, you also know what exactly we are talking about in a property. Okay. So now another property is your set difference. I think most of you have studied this one, set difference. is just take two regular languages and delete or take a subtraction or minus one from other, the resulting one should also be a regular. So it is again closed under this one. So again, it can easily be proved by a constructive proof. Okay, so I can prove this by a constructive proof. Okay, so I will show you the proof, how the proof is given in that context here. Okay, so now I can say that L1. Okay, so before proving that, because I need some expression here, so just hold this for a moment. This is L1 minus L2, and it can be written as L1 intersection L2 and L2 complement. So we haven't done intersection yet. So that's the sixth property I will say is your intersection one. So I just do an intersection proof, intersection property. So what is the intersection property? So if you're taking the two languages, L1 intersection L2, so you can write it in another way. You just take a De Morgan's of it. So you can write it like that. If you take a De Morgan's of it, it will become this bar here, L1 bar bar. And because this is a De Morgan's, you can complement it. The plus becomes the add. If you have studied in, what is the subject? Digital electronics. So AND becomes OR becomes AND. So intersection, now this is your union, it becomes your intersection. And in the same way, L2 becomes this one. So because double bars cancels out, so it is the same thing. Okay. So based on the De Morgan's law, I'm saying that. Now, if you clearly look at it, how to give a constructive proof. The constructive proof will be based on the things that we have already proved. Okay, so what we have proved? We have proved that if this is a regular language, I'm talking about L1 is a regular and L2 is regular. Keep that thing in mind. I will always take only regular languages because I'm talking about a regular set here. Okay, so keep that thing in mind. So I already know that the regular language is closed under complementation. It is already proved. Okay, so this fifth one is already proved that this is a regular one. So I can write like this. This R1 is a regular again. Another, I will take a complementation of L2 here. I will again get a regular language. Okay, so again, it is raised to the power of bar. Now, L1 union L2, so it is R1 plus R2. Okay, so again, I have proved that thing that R1 union R2 is again a regular expression. So you can write it like this. In the end, you got a regular raised to the power of a bar here. So we have already proved that that the complementation of a regular language is again regular. Okay, so you again get a regular expression. So this intersection is again closed under this one. Okay, so I have shown you the proof of this. This is also another proof of a set difference. So I will show you one or two proof so that you understand that what I'm saying exactly. Okay, so now it can also be written like this: L1 intersection L2 union. So if you want to check that it is correct or not, so I just take examples to show you. So consider in our scenario, universal set looks like this: A, B, C, D, E, F, G, something like this. Okay. So now in this L1 is this A, B, C, take L1, and take L2 is B, C, D. Okay, so I'm just taking this is, you have also seen this expression in set theory. I'm proving this, that these two expressions are equal. So if you remember, what is the set difference? The elements of L1 which are not in L2. Okay, so the set difference expression, the set difference definition goes like this: when you are applying a set difference here, that will like this: L1 minus L2. So the answer will be the elements of L2, L1, which are not in L2. Okay, so if you are applying L2 minus L1, so it will be the elements of L2 which are not in L1. Not in L1. So that is a basic definition of it. Again, what are the elements of L1 that are not in L2? So A is not there, B is there, C is also there. So the elements of L1 which is not in L2 is A. You can directly write like the set difference between L2, L1 minus L2 is A. In the similar way, the elements of L2, which is not in L1, I think is D. BC is already there, so the result will be D here, okay? So if you don't understand this definition here, you just write it like this. What is L1? A, B, C. And what is L2? B, C, D. So just delete this one, B and C. And whatever you get with the L1, you just write it like this, L1. Okay, so in the same way for L2, L2, write the L2 first, B, C, D minus A, B, C. So just delete this one, B and C will be deleted, and what is remaining, D. Okay, so you can also do that. Okay, so now for this one, now I am saying that it is equivalent to L1 intersection L2 complement. So now just take the complement of L2 here. So how to take the complement of L2? Just what is L2 here? That is BCD. So I don't want this. So our universal set is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So I have to delete those element here. So the complement is it should not, if this is a BCD, okay. And this is a universal set, and that I do not want that set. I want the remaining part. So how do I get the remaining part? I will not include BCD. So I have to include all the universal set, okay? So what exactly you will get by taking the complement of L2? What is the opposite of BCD? That you have not, you will not include BCD. So what is the universal here? It will become A, E, F, and G. So if I take a complement of L2, it will become A, E, F, G, and intersection. What is L1 here, which is A, B, and C. Now you just take an intersection of these two. What is the common between them? That is your A. You get the same thing, and if you apply for L2 minus L1, you will again get the same thing, okay? So that is why I'm saying that these two things are equivalent. So you can write L1 minus L2 like L1 intersection L2 union, L2 in complement, okay? So now again, by constructive proof, if you take a look at it, L1 intersection L2 union, now again, this if you take this L2 and we take the complement of this one, we have again proved this. This is the fifth property of complementation. This is again regular, and take a intersection of it, and this is again a regular language. So I can write it L1. So don't worry about that. So now this is again a regular language, and take an intersection of this. And this intersection is already proved that this is also closed under regular languages are also closed under intersection. So the resulting thing you will get is also a regular, okay? So that is why I can say that for this one, this intersection one, it is also closed here, okay? Okay. So now the remaining properties, I think, are reversal. I will talk about reversal. How many properties have we done till now? So I will discuss this property completely. So whatever be the remaining property, most particular properties I will also discuss. So don't worry about it. The properties that are not given in the table, I will also discuss about it. So don't you have to know about this property, that what exactly this signifies. Like ninth property is homomorphism. I just write it like this. And 10th property is inverse homomorphism. And 11th property is right quotient, and 12th property is substitution. Okay, so I will talk about these property in the next lecture. Okay, so I think that for today it is enough. Okay, so the remaining property, I think these are the remaining property. Only five remaining properties are there. I will discuss in the next lecture. And before giving your before going out, just I want to say that tomorrow will be your quiz. Okay, so that quiz is also based on